saving the world. We were convinced that Hubbard was the returned savior, and that his techniques and his knowledge and his majesty would eventually bring all mankind to an enlightened state, and that was what we were doing.
There were some things about him that I did feel were rather dangerous. I fell so much under his spell that I told my roommate, if ever I told you I was going to marry this man, she should tie me up and not allow me out of the house.
I was overwhelmed. Here I am in the presence of the most important individual in the cosmos. I mean, you know, this isn't just like meeting a film star or something. I'm meeting God with plus signs.
Lafayette Ron Hubbard created one of the richest and most controversial cults of our time, the Church of Scientology. He spent much of his later life at sea, on the run from those who accused him of being a crook and a charlatan. But to the millions who at one time or another followed him, and to himself, he was the greatest guru who ever lived.
There is one thing you can say about Dianetics and Scientology, and I'm sorry if this sounds odd, but it isn't everybody who can write a book that turns the world on its ear.
But more remarkable still was the story of Ron Hubbard's life. The story of a science fiction fantasist turned self-proclaimed messiah. Ron Hubbard was determined that from the start his life would be the stuff of legend. He was born in 1911 and told of how he was brought up on his grandfather's ranch in Montana, which, he said in a newspaper interview, covered a quarter of the state. As a small child, he was breaking broncos and hunting coyote. He claimed he grew up with old frontiersmen and cowboys, and even became a blood brother of the local Blackfoot Indians. These were all splendid tales, but all that is known for sure is that while he did used to visit the small livery stables his grandfather owned, he was brought up in an ordinary home. The only child of ordinary American parents. Towards the end of World War I, his father joined the American Navy, and the teenage Hubbard spent holidays in Guam, where the family was stationed. He traveled in China and the East. With a taste for adventure, he went prospecting for gold in Puerto Rico, and as a student, even led a sea exploration to find pirates' haunts in the Caribbean. But he couldn't resist gilding the lily. A Scientology book later recorded his claim to have communed with native bandits in the high hills of Tibet. But there's no evidence he ever went to Tibet.
He told so many stories of exploits of his in South America and the West Indies and places that he would have to be at least 483 years old to have had enough time to have done all those things. But that doesn't really matter. I mean, it was just very entertaining, really. Except that he turned it into a religion.
Even when he was a teenager, in his diaries, he was writing little stories, you know, sea adventures and yarns. That sometimes when some of his own representatives found them, they thought these were true. You know, there was an escapade of him fighting an octopus that once one of his personal representatives was telling as a true story, and I had to point out to her later, no, this is just one of his stories that he's interspersing with his private diaries.
When he was 22, Hubbard married his first wife, Polly. They went to live on Puget Sound in Washington State and soon had two children. Hubbard's joy in life was sailing and exploring, but now he had to settle down and earn some money. With such a prolific imagination, he became a writer, starting with adventures and fantasies for the Penny Dreadfuls. Then he turned to science fiction and became a bestseller. Two books, Final Blackout and Fear, were considered sci-fi classics. But Hubbard's most amazing story was about himself. His literary agent was Furry Ackerman, himself a sci-fi fanatic. One night, deep into the small hours, Hubbard told Ackerman of a bizarre event in a hospital theatre. It was an event that would shape his entire life.
He said that he had died on the operating table. And he rose in spirit form and he looked at the body that he had previously inhabited and he shrugged the shoulders he didn't have anymore and he thought, well, then where do we go from here? Off in the distance, he saw a great ornate gate. And it looked kind of interesting to him, so he wafted over to it, and the gate, as they do in supernatural films, just opened without any human assistance. He floated through, and on the other side, he saw an intellectual smorgasbord of everything that had ever puzzled the mind of man. You know, how did it all begin? What is God's purpose? Where do we go from here? Are there past lives? Are there future lives? And like a sponge, he was just absorbing all of this esoteric information. And all of a sudden, there was kind of a swishing in the air, and he heard a voice, no, not yet, he's not ready. And like a long umbilical cord, he felt himself being pulled back, and he lay down in his body, and he opened his eyes, and he said to the nurse, I was dead, wasn't I? Then he bounded off the operating table. I don't know how you die, and the next minute you're bounding off an operating table. He got 2 reams of paper and a gallon of scalding black coffee. And at the end of 2 days, he had a manuscript called Excalibur or The Dark Sword. And he told me that whoever read it either went insane or committed suicide. And he said the last time he had shown it to a publisher in New York, he walked into the office to find out what the reaction was. Publisher called for the reader. The reader came with the manuscript, threw it on the table, and threw himself out of the skyscraper window.
But was Hubbard's extraordinary story true? Excalibur became the stuff of mystery. Hubbard told friends it was too dangerous to publish. But 40 years later, a treasure trove from Hubbard's early journals and manuscripts, believed to have been long lost, was discovered by his staff.
There were 2.5 versions of Excalibur. I read them and I didn't go mad and didn't die. They also include the information within related writings that these came out of a nitrous oxide incident. Hubbard had a couple of teeth extracted, and it was while under the effect of nitrous oxide that he came up with Excalibur.
Hubbard's death was, in fact, an hallucination under the effects of anesthetic. So what was the intellectual dish he'd fed on?
It's not particularly revolutionary. The key to Excalibur was this great realization by Hubbard of survive as being the one command that all existence and all life and all people have. That became the basis for a lot of Dianetics and a lot of Scientology.
This idea had a profound impact on Hubbard. In a letter to Polly, he wrote, "I have high hopes of smashing my name into history so violently that it will take a legendary form." The Second World War brought a new dimension to the Hubbard legend. He said that while serving in the United States Navy, he'd been blinded, but that inspired by the insights he'd first glimpsed when he died on the operating table, he'd dramatically been able to cure himself.
By 1948, through my own processing and use of the principles I had isolated up to that time, was able to pass a 100% combat physical, which was very mysterious to the government. How had I suddenly become completely physically well from being blind and lame?
It was an odd story, because Hubbard's war record shows his recurring problem was a stomach ulcer. There are mentions of conjunctivitis, but none of blindness. Indeed, none of his Navy medical reports before, during, or after the war contain any suggestion of blindness. Only short-sightedness and astigmatism. After the war, Hubbard went to Hollywood. As a successful science fiction author, he was a welcome visitor to the Los Angeles Science Fantasy Association. Its members recalled there was one power over the mind he undoubtedly did possess. Hypnotism.
Ron Hubbard came to our club, and he hypnotized all of the members except me. I wanted to remain in present time and watch what was going on. And I remember it was fascinating. He told one boy that he had a little kangaroo in the palm of his hands, and the boy was going all around showing everybody his little kangaroo that was hopping around.
In writings and conversations, Hubbard began to speak of his new science of the mind. As Scientology's literature would later depict, Hubbard claimed that in addition to himself, he cured 11 other war veterans and restored sanity to 40 mental patients.
Rumors are beginning to circulate that this new science of mind, or this new philosophy, had a significance for mankind that was greater than the discovery of the wheel and equal in significance to the discovery of fire.
In the May 1950 edition of Astounding Science Fiction magazine, Hubbard published his stunning findings as fact. Dianetics was truly born. Thousands of letters poured into the magazine. In the meantime, Hubbard had been pounding the typewriter keys, putting his ideas into a 450-page book. It became a bestseller, and Dianetics a national craze. Hubbard's theory was that the human mind was bedeviled by engrams, memories of painful events, often imprinted before birth on the fetus. He claimed that under the direction of a Dianetics therapist, or auditor, as he called them, these engrams could be relived and then cleared from the mind. At this stage, Dianetics seemed just an exaggerated form of psychotherapy.
Well, Dianetics was so popular because it promised a brave new world of everybody cleared, no more colds, no more eyeglasses, cured me of a fear of dogs.
Among the various things it was said to be able to do was one person had lost a tooth, and through Dianetic auditing, he regrew the tooth. Almost any illness could be cured. Schizophrenia could be cured.
Seemed like it opened up the whole world for everybody to become perfect human beings.
Hubbard sold Dianetics auditing courses at $500 a go. The money was rolling in, but he was about to be accused of being a con man. With his book Dianetics a bestseller, Ron Hubbard was America's new guru. In August 1950, at a lecture hall in Los Angeles, he presented to a crowd of 6,000 the first person to be what he called a clear. She was a student called Sonia Bianca. As a clear, she was supposed to have total recall.
So various members of the audience called questions at her. Could she remember what was said on page 217 of her physics textbook? She couldn't. Could she remember what she had had for breakfast on the morning of August 17th, 1946? She couldn't. Then various people called out for Hubbard to turn his back on her and see if she could remember the color of his tie. She couldn't. And so that was... At that moment, the whole business sort of collapsed. People started leaving the auditorium.
Suddenly, Hubbard was in trouble. He was accused of being a con man, and Dianetics, a form of hypnotism, a technique at which he was so expert. He recruited a bright young PR woman, Barbara Kay, to repair his damaged image.
Well, I've always found that it's the mind of a man that is most sexy. He was not really terribly physically attractive, and he had a brilliant mind, no question about that. And I surely thought this was a man who was interested in marrying me and whom I might be interested in marrying.
The intellectual attraction turned into an affair, and Barbara stayed with the 40-year-old Hubbard in an apartment in Hollywood. But by now, Hubbard had left Polly and was married to his second wife, Sarah. He'd led Barbara to believe the marriage with Sarah was over. It wasn't.
It was quite shocking when, shortly after moving some of my things into that apartment, suddenly Sarah turned up with the baby and moved in. And I believe he was just as dismayed as I, because the next day when he came to the office with some of my belongings, like my cologne and my toothbrush and so forth, he looked very downtrodden and apologetic and not happy about the situation at all.
Nevertheless, Barbara was kicked out. Dianetics was still in trouble. After the initial success of the book, money had rolled in and rolled out just as fast. Hubbard went to Palm Springs to try to recoup his fortune with a follow-up book. But the business, his marriage with Sarah, and his writing were in crisis. He asked Barbara to come to him.
He was certainly very depressed. He had lost the color in his face. His voice was hardly audible. He told me that he was totally blocked. He was working under a publisher's deadline, which he was failing to meet. He believed that his inability to write was due to the sinister interventions of other people, such as Sarah hypnotizing him in his sleep and telling him he will never write again. I found him paranoid, you know. He was clearly going through clinical depression.
Worse followed. Hubbard and Sarah finally split up. Their divorce became a public sensation. Sarah accused Hubbard of torturing her and declared him insane. Hubbard denounced Sarah as a Russian spy and kidnapped their 13-month-old daughter. Hubbard ended up in Wichita in Kansas and got back in touch with Barbara.
He sent me a wire telling me he'd been very ill and said he wanted to marry me. And when I went to Wichita, he looked terrible. He had hair down to his shoulders and fingernails were like talons. And I found a note, a very sweet note in my hotel room saying, "Glad you're here, I love you." But I saw that I had a man there who had no prospects, for one thing, and that he had some psychiatric difficulties, and I didn't see much of a life for myself with that sort of individual. So I left.
But Hubbard bounced back. He got married for the third time to one of his students, Mary Sue Whipp. This marriage lasted, and Mary Sue would become his devoted deputy. Sarah, his second wife, was cleared from his memory, just like an engram.
How many times have I been married? I've been married twice. And I'm very happily married just now. I have a lovely wife, and I have four children. My first wife is dead.
What happened to your second wife?
I never had a second wife.
In 1952... Hubbard launched a revolutionary new product, Scientology. Dianetics originally covered this life only, but in a new book, Scientology, A History of Man, Hubbard revealed that wasn't enough. Human bodies were in fact inhabited by immortal souls, or thetans, going back to primeval times. Hubbard's son from his first marriage, Nibs, claimed the book stemmed from an unusual piece of drug-driven research.
LRH gave his son Nibs some amphetamines, and Nibs started talking, he said. Started really going, talking fast, you know, speed. And he kept talking, and he kept talking, and his dad kept giving him speed, and all of a sudden he was talking about his history when he was a clam and all these different situations in early Earth. And out of that came History of Man.
Suddenly you were nobody. Oh, I've been back 3 lives, you know. I've been back 7, you know. I was in the time of Pharaoh. Well, when it got back to the individual who was a clam lying on a primordial seashore with a grain of sand irritating a pearl inside it, I decided that was as far back as I wanted to go, and I just departed from Scientology altogether.
In late 1952, Hubbard came to London. He was still in financial trouble back home. A business partner had just issued a warrant for the return of $9,000 Hubbard had borrowed. To make money, he needed to go international. And here, instead of creditors, he found a new group of adoring fans.
He was really flamboyant. I mean, he was full of life. I mean, he rode about on his Harley motorcycle, and we threw parties, and he would play his guitar and, you know, just sing and put on his cowboy hat. And I mean, he was just lots and lots of fun. We'd all get together, and then we would do various exercises, and we'd go out and see if just with thoughts we could knock off policemen's hats, or, you know, what kind of power did we have in terms of thinking and thought and energy and that sort of thing. I mean, it was great fun.
I thought it would give me total control of my own life. I mean, it sounds ridiculous, doesn't it? But I mean, put in those terms, that's basically what Hubbard was saying. He was saying that you and everyone else, with the use of Scientology or Dianetics at that time, could become a god. And we were all, if you like, fallen gods.
The next step was to create a church for his new gods. A writer friend called Lloyd Eschbach later recalled how, after a dinner in the late 1940s, Hubbard had said, "I'd like to start a religion. That's where the money is." Now, a few years later, the Church of Scientology was born. In America in particular, there were sound practical reasons.
There are tax advantages, and there are advantages in the Constitution, which says that the government may not abridge the operations of a church. And I think that that, more than anything else, made him agree to using that vehicle, because it is, and has indeed proved, to be very difficult for any government to abridge the activities of a church.
Hubbard found the perfect cathedral for his church, St. Hill Manor, in East Grinstead in Sussex. He played his new role, the country squire. He told the locals that he was a scientist researching plants and their reaction to pain. He and his young family settled into Sussex society, bringing American razzmatazz to East Grinstead's road safety campaign. But the locals hadn't realized that St. Hill was to become the mecca of Scientology. Devotees arrived from all over the world to study at their master's feet.
I'm Jim Mondeer from L.A.
They paid thousands of pounds for Hubbard's courses.
Now, the mind, when it has an old experience, will add that data into its current experience, and it keeps coming up with wrong answers.
Virginia Downsborough was on the first St. Hill clearing course.
Ron had such an amazing ability for making you feel that you were just so important to him and so valued. So many people wanted to do what he wanted, wanted to show him their best efforts, wanted to contribute, wanted to be part, you know. It was, again, this wait for me, let me come along with this wonderful game you're playing.
Central to the game was Hubbard's E-meter, a form of lie detector which he claimed could electrically detect emotional charge.
Students spent hours, days, months, sometimes years, going over painful events, or engrams, in this or their past lives, trying to make the needle float. Proof that the engram was now cleared from their memories.
That's it. Clear 386 Lee Echo.
It's like nothing else in the world. It's really, I feel quite free.
Hubbard had designed an ingenious commercial product. The more past lives, the more memories, the more engrams to be cleared, all in a complex series of expensive courses.
Making money, I think, to Hubbard was paramount. He wasn't that interested in it for himself. He did have perks. He did have his cars, his motorbikes, his books, his good food, and things like that. And eventually he had his villas and he had his estates and so on. But the money that he wanted predominantly was for power.
Hubbard wanted to create a worldwide army of Scientologists. Going clear was only the first step. After that, further courses could improve your IQ, improve your work, turn you into a superman.
The purpose of Scientology was to make the able more able. And he was always striving for that. And in everything he did, I think he was looking at that. Now, his idea was that if you could get every single person looking in the same direction, then you'd have a very powerful nation, you see.
This photograph, composed by Ron Hubbard himself, betrays an extraordinary ambition he held for Scientology.
The entire objective was to find a place that Hubbard could eventually turn into his own kingdom, with his own government, his own passports, his own monetary system. In other words, his own principality that he would be the benign dictator of. That was the objective.
He had been having some auditing and doing some investigative auditing and looking at past lives and past experiences, and he ran into what he thought might be the past life of Cecil Rhodes. So he went to Rhodesia to check out what he had discovered in his auditing.
He was there to attempt to create a Scientology community in the country and eventually turn the country over into a Scientology country. He was looking for a home base for Scientology.
Hubbard's vision of becoming a latter-day Rhodes failed. The Rhodesian government became suspicious of him, and his visa was not renewed. Back in England, Hubbard was also under attack. Parents were worried by strange communications from children who'd fallen under Scientology's thrall.
There was a letter from her saying that she was disconnecting from me. You probably are familiar with this, you've seen it in the paper, but that I was destroying her and that she didn't want to see me again. That's it, car, and it was signed.
The newspapers were accusing him of being a fraud and lobbied the government to launch an inquiry.
When the fire goes off, you know by the number that went off?
Hubbard decided there was only one answer. He would take to the high seas. With his loyal band of disciples, he would move himself and his empire outside any government's jurisdiction.
At one point, he turned around and said to us in a very sort of masterful way, in a very almost ambassadorial sort of way, he said, it's perfectly all right to step outside the law, because the law itself is aberrated. So in order to achieve our ends, that gives us license to step outside the law.
Hubbard's followers were about to see the consequences of life beyond the law, as the Messiah became their dictator. In 1967, with his own navy of Scientologists, the Sea Organization, Ron Hubbard set sail. Hannah Eltringham, then 24, went with him. She'd never crewed on a large ship before, but Hubbard detected that she was unusually well-equipped for naval command.
Hubbard called me into his cabin and stood right in the doorway of his cabin, fiddling with the E-meter, and I started asking me questions about when I had last been a captain. Well, this could only be past lives, because I'd never been a captain in this life. So I started, you know, thinking back and came up with this past experience about being a space captain of a spaceship and being blown up in space and the planet was being invaded and all this fighting and blasting going on and so forth. And at the end of it, he peered over the e-meter at me and he said, "Were you one of the loyal officers?" And at that point, I got this uprush and I felt, good, I must have been one of those loyal officers. I must have been one of the elite.
The young Hannah was appointed captain of Hubbard's number 2 ship, a 400-ton trawler. His flagship was a 3,000-ton converted cattle ferry. On board, Hubbard had a personal guard called the Commodore's Messengers.
They took care of everything for him. They dressed him. They got him ready for bed. They lit his cigarettes. They held his ashtray.
Most of the messengers are young girls, 13, 14, 15. They were an extension of his communication. So when somebody saw them on the ship or they came up to them, it was like you were talking to him.
On one occasion, Jerry Armstrong, who'd been sent on a shore errand, was visited by one of Hubbard's messengers.
This was Terry, who was later to be my wife, and she came to me where I was working, and she said, "The Commodore wants to know, is it true that you went to the U.S. Embassy and applied for 30-some-odd visas?" And I said, "Yes, sir," because that's how you respond to the messenger. And her next message was, "The Commodore says you're a fucking asshole."
The attacks on Scientology had pitched Hubbard into one of his periodic depressions. His response was to take it out on his followers on sea and land. He designed a new disciplinary code called ethics, which put many of them into what he called lower conditions of existence, like liability, doubt, or treason. To rise out of these conditions, penances were required. Liability, for example, required you to deliver an effective blow to Scientology's enemies.
Everybody was supposedly in these lower conditions, which was quite astonishing because everybody really loved Ron and wanted to contribute to having whatever his dreams might be come true.
What happened was it became a very heavy, almost military organization. People changed. I think people became scared. They were scared of ethics, scared of what would happen, and so they became, I think, very intimidated.
At sea, the cruelty extended to children. On one occasion, Hubbard was infuriated by a small boy who had unwittingly chewed a telex.
He put this 4.5-year-old little boy, Derek Green, into the chain locker for 2 days and 2 nights. It's a closed metal container. It's wet, it's full of water and seaweed, it smells bad. But Derek was sitting up on the chain in this place on his own in the dark for 2 days and 2 nights. He was not allowed to go to the party. I mean, he had to go in the chain locker on his own, soil himself. He was given food. And I never went near it, the chain locker, while he was in there, but people heard him crying. That is sheer total brutality. That's child abuse.
People were in awe of him and people were frightened of him. He was the boss. He was the dictator. He could order anyone to do anything on board. He was ruthless. He could be at times charming, but he could also be very belligerent. And he could also be very uncaring and cruel.
Yet Hubbard's disciples continued to believe in him. In 1968, he took a select few around the Mediterranean on his yacht, the Enchanter, on a project he called the Mission into Time. The task was to find treasure Hubbard had buried during his previous lives.
We were in a tizzy, you know, all this excitement of this upcoming, very important mission. And I was amongst one of the chosen, and we sailed off with our metal detectors and went to a variety of locations and did find some metal at the basement of what he claimed used to be a temple in which he had liaisons with some priestess during his trips to Sardinia. There was metal buried down below, and he was very triumphant during those times. It was very heady stuff for us people. It had a very magical, magnetic, hypnotizing effect on the followers.
Hubbard was also engaged on a further great expansion of Scientology. Once a Scientologist reached the state of clear, he became an operating thetan, or OT. Hubbard now designed a series of secret OT levels. Each one was part of an unfolding saga, which revealed that we are all infested by thetans, the souls of exiles from the Galactic Federation, which under Prince Xenu ruled this sector of the galaxy 95 million years ago. If you ever reached the top OT level, you would have crossed the bridge to total freedom. As always in Scientology, each OT level could only be reached after an expensive course. Did Hubbard believe it, or was he having his followers on?
He probably always knew he was running a con. You know, he must have known that much of the stuff he was talking about was sort of rubbish. But I think after a while, when he found there were thousands of people and the adulation around the planet for this man, I think that started to take him over. I think he began to believe that he was, if not God, then very close to God.
Hubbard's new cosmology was accompanied by new forms of punishment on board ship. Crew members who displeased him were liable to be thrown overboard before being retrieved from the harbour below. If they reoffended, they were tied up and blindfolded first.
I saw one woman, Julia Lewis Salmon, from the United States, thrown overboard. This woman must have been in her 50s. She had her hands and I think her feet tied, maybe only her hands tied and a blindfold. But she went over. She was so panicked at the thought of being thrown over this way. She was standing on the edge of the deck, panicked, beside herself, shouting. And I was standing on the A deck with Hubbard and his other aides watching this going on. And Julia didn't jump over. She had to be pushed over because she was incapable. She was in such a fit.
He saw everyone suspiciously and assumed everyone was intentionally attacking him. Governments were attacking him. And then everyone around who made a mistake, they also were attacking him. And the only thing he could do would be to attack back.
In 1973, a French court started proceedings against Hubbard for fraud. He had left his ship, which was berthed in Morocco, and went to live in hiding in New York, where he was looked after by Jim DenKelsey. To turn the tables on his enemies, he devised a bizarre plan called Snow White. Its stated aim was to correct false reports about Scientology. It led to Scientology members infiltrating government departments. Hubbard even issued a reading list for learning the black arts of espionage.
He believed that there was an international cabal that was in control of the attack on him around the world, as well as the attacks on various countries. And so Snow White was written to find this cabal, find all the connections between all these enemy groups, to expose them, to destroy them. It was done through infiltration. In some cases, it was done through burglary. It was just pure military intelligence.
Having instigated Snow White, Hubbard rejoined his ship in the Canary Islands. There he had a serious motorbike accident. His mood dramatically worsened.
This was his period, which I call the pouting, the crying, the mad period, where he would cry and throw things against the wall, the bulkheads, and pout and scream. But right toward the tail end of that, he created the RPF, the Rehabilitation Project Force.
The RPF was yet another correctional regime. Its orders were fearsome. As ship's captain, it was Hannah Eltringham's job to implement them.
I was absolutely horrified when I read them, because they talked about the creation of this pretty much like a slave labor camp. Those weren't the words used, but that was the impression given, where the unwanteds, those found wanting, seriously wanting, were sent, and they were to be kept in this with no rights, no freedoms, no privileges of any kind. Pretty much the basic rights they were allowed were a little bit of sleep each day, food leftovers, the harshest treatment. They were not allowed to speak to any of the crew. It was very, very, very bad that this was going on. But Hubbard's statement to us was that it's going to take a lot more ethics and a lot more punishment than anyone can easily face up to get this whole world back in shape. And at that point, I believed that statement.
Human emotion and reaction is the way humans were. And he didn't specially regard humans very highly. He liked the idea of the doll bodies that were in other civilizations. Doll bodies didn't have human emotions and reactions. They were, I guess, like Spock, you know, just very analytical. You just get the job done. No emotions there. Love is not a sentiment that's known or cared for. So, and that's, to me, the tragedy, because he put that, I feel, into the organization and into the way of being in the organization.
Hubbard even consigned his own son, Quentin, who was a senior auditor on the ship, to the RPF.
Quentin really was a real sweet kid. He was a real nice guy and very soft-spoken. And it was very difficult for him, being Hubbard's son and being put on in this very high position, and I don't think he was that interested in it. He just wanted to be a pilot, and also the fact that he was gay. And that's a very tough thing in Scientology, to be gay, because especially that kid, to be Hubbard's son and to be this top technical person and be gay, oh, that would be a horrible thing to be wrestling with and suppressing all the time.
Quentin was sent to the RPF after he committed the sin of trying to commit suicide. 2 years later, he succeeded.
Hubbard saw it as a betrayal because everything was referenced around him. The world was doing everything to him. This technology that was supposed to work didn't even work on the senior person of all technology. You know, Hubbard and his son, you know, no, he just saw that as an attack from his son. And that's, you know, the love was gone. He had lost love.
In 1975, Hubbard decided it was time to come ashore. He sent scouts to look for a suitable land base. They settled on Clearwater, in the rich state of Florida.
He stated coming ashore would be profitable because we could get so many more people to the flag land base, as it was to be called, for auditing and training. And he also wanted to concentrate on getting professionals to the land base because, of course, they had more accessible money. They had pension funds, they had children's education funds, and some of these he named that were accessible.
Hubbard knew Scientology would be unwelcome, so he devised a top-secret battle plan. He called it Operation Goldmine. Using a cover name, the United Churches of Florida, Hubbard issued secret orders to take over the town.
These orders, in effect, very clearly stated, move into this area, find out who your friends are, develop them, find out who your enemies are, destroy them, and then move into every possible area of community life, business, social, religious, education.
The plan worked. Clearwater is a Scientology bastion. Scientology owns many prime sites. Big-name Scientologists like Lisa Marie Presley have moved in.
get all the big high rollers, you get the people with the dollars, and you can make a fortune. And I believe the income for a week, this is like in 1970, 78, 79, was somewhere as $500,000 a week. I mean, that's where the big bucks started to be made, when you could do that.
With the money rolling in, Hubbard moved to California, where he'd play his last great role. His ambition was to film sci-fi blockbusters based on his books, but he ended up making Scientology training films.
The movie mogul, Cecil B. DeMille. You know, it was like he was. He tried to be bigger than life, but he just wasn't. So he would make these extravagant sets. They were ludicrous. They were not big productions. They were just silliness. They were an egomaniac. He tried to be flustery and big and powerful, but if you look, just stepped and observed, you could see that he had fear about everything. And finally, the fear came down to dust particles, little teeny dust particles.
He had phobias about dust. He had phobias about smells. He had phobias about sounds. So he would hear sounds that weren't there, and he would scream at the sound technician. And he would see things that weren't there, and he would scream at the people who were framing the shot. And he would smell smells that weren't there, and he'd have people rinse his clothing some 13 or 15 or however many times.
In 1977, while Hubbard was away making movies, the FBI caught up with the Snow White operation and raided Scientology headquarters in Los Angeles and Washington. Hubbard's wife, Mary Sue, and eight other Scientology executives were convicted and sentenced for conspiracy and stealing government documents. Hubbard disappeared, never to be seen publicly again. After living in a succession of hiding places, he ended up on this secluded ranch in the California hills. Secrecy has veiled his final years, but one man, Robert Vaughan Young, who was then a Scientology public relations officer, was later given a description of Hubbard by one of his guardians. This, and evidence from Hubbard's autopsy report, paint a sad picture.
He had grown a beard, he had grown his long hair. The nails were long, very much in the same problem as they found out with Howard Hughes, unkempt nails. There was a neighbor that walked in on him one day, and he had become very frightened and suddenly scurried out of the barn. He was frightened to meet people. He was terrified of meeting any new people. He was disappearing down, down, down into this little strange world of his that he had created. And the irony of this is a man that was promulgating and telling the world that with my technology and ideas you can get bigger and bigger and bigger, and yet he was shrinking down until finally he was hiding.
On January the 24th, 1986, Ron Hubbard died. The Church of Scientology said he'd simply quit his body to continue his work elsewhere.
Him dying suddenly made him very mortal. And the last thing we could have is to have Hubbard be mortal. So a story had to be designed. And the story is that he went off to research the next level. And what's amazing is how the Scientologists bought this without any questioning. They bought it.
Today, the L. Ron Hubbard image is carefully protected by the Church of Scientology. It says he is the greatest humanitarian in history. Hollywood has named a street after him, and millions of dollars roll into Scientology every year. It continues to preach that Hubbard's teachings are the best solution to the mental problems of the world. The personal tragedy is, one mind Scientology did not appear to help was that of its founder.
Secret Lives next Wednesday at 9 profiles the holiday camp king, Billy Butlin. Our film next tonight on 4 is Caddyshack.